Hi everyone, we're just going to crack on with our annotations of the section called Jezebels, and I will put a slide with the literary historical context on Jezebel from the Bible into the file section on our Teams for you. However, let me just take you through a few brief things. So Jezebel, the word Jezebel now is synonymous with a beautiful, alluring, exotic prostitute who entices men. And that comes from a story in the Bible in the Old Testament where the queen, the wife of King Ahab, who wasn't an Israelite, but he was an Israelite, seduced him away from God and into worshipping the idols of Baal and Asherah. And as Ahab and therefore Israel, hold on, there we go, Israel rejected God, she was punished for kind of causing that, and she was thrown out of a window and her flesh was eaten by dogs. And the way that this particular Bible character became synonymous with the idea of a prostitute is that she was described as being very beautiful, and she used her looks to seduce Ahab away from God. And then in the very early pictorial depictions of Jezebel, she's seen as wearing makeup, and she's called originally this idea of kind of these kind of Middle Eastern women being painted ladies, and that's where that comes from, and it kind of has continued to be associated with prostitution. So that's just a few notes on this section. As you know, because we've talked about it before, Jezebel's, the place in Gilead, is the underground club that the commander takes Ofred to, which is full of prostitutes, and this is where Moira has been sent to work as part of her punishment for attempting to escape. But before we get to actually Jezebel's, we need to read chapter 31, which is where we learn all about how the systems in Gilead are abused by nearly everybody. And so we have a little bit more about the resistance organization through Ofglen. Then we find out that potentially the commander is infertile, and we have this suggestion by Serena Joy that Ofred has a physical relationship with Nick in order to give her a baby. So we're just going to scoot through this chapter and do some annotations. Every night when I go to bed, I think. In the morning, I will wake up in my own house and things will be back the way they were. It hasn't happened this morning either. And what's interesting here is we have this tension in Gilead repeated throughout this chapter. This idea that there is this tension between hope and desperation, and you know, one side of those, it's like a weighing scales, one side of those is always more powerful. I put on my clothes, summer clothes. It's still summer. It seems to have stopped at summer, July. It's breathless days and sauna nights, hard to sleep. To make a point of keeping track, I should scratch marks on the wall, one for each day of the week, and run a line through them when I have seven, which is a kind of cliche as we see of prisoners scratching off the marks. Obviously, you know that when we do this, we do four and then put a line through them. Ofred here says seven, and that's because seven in the Christian religion is this number of kind of completeness, which is, you know, why we have 7 days of the week. But and you know, God created the world in 7 days. What would be the use? This isn't a jail sentence. there's no time here that can be done and finished with, as in she doesn't get free like a prisoner. Anyway, all I have to do is ask to find out what day it was. Yesterday was July the 4th, which used to be Independence Day, which of course is the day when America celebrates its independence from the British monarchy, before they abolished it. And so of course they don't celebrate something that would have the word Independence Day. September the 1st will still be Labor Day. They still have that, though it didn't used to have anything to do with mothers. And so we have Labor Day in this country. Our Labor is an extra bank holiday. Our Labor Day is an extra bank holiday in May. That's given to just so that workers can have an extra holiday off as a bank holiday where they still get paid. They have that in September in America. And so Labour here, as in Labour Day, is about workers. What Gilead have done is to change it into a celebration of motherhood. And then she says, I tell the time by the moon, lunar, not solar. And of course, as you'll know, kind of mythologically, the moon has always been linked with the female, and the sun, kind of mythologically and astrologically, is male. I bend over to do up my red shoes, lighter weight these days with discreet slits cut in them, though nothing so daring as sandals. It's an effort to stoop, despite the exercises. I can feel my body gradually seizing up, refusing. So not only is this this sense of the kind of passivity of the handmaid's lifestyle, even though they go out to do these walks, these kind of daily walks, it's a very gentle, calm lifestyle. But in this passage, in this chapter, we get these reminders that Offred isn't getting any younger. And although she's not old, her body is beginning to behave as if it were. Being a woman this way is how I used to imagine it would be, to be very old. I feel I even walk that way, crouched over, kind of hunched, my spine constricting to a question mark. And of course, that's the constant question about her body, is will she get pregnant? My bones leached of calcium and porous as limestone. When I was younger, imagining age, I would think, maybe you appreciate things more when you don't have much time left. I forgot to include the loss of energy, and that's that kind of that question there. Is that to do with the rationing, the lack of food, her loss of energy? Is it to do with the depression that she kind of has to constantly battle against in order to stay positive, in order to stay hopeful? Some days I do appreciate things more, eggs, flowers, but then I decide I'm only having an attack of sentimentality, my brain going pastel technicolor, like the beautiful sunset greeting cards they used to make so many of in California, high gloss hearts. The danger is grey out, and this idea that she is, you know, this danger that she has, this kind of constant loss of any interest in anything. I'd like to have Luke here in this bedroom while I'm getting dressed so I could have a fight with him. And this is this again with often with her memories of Luke, is this miss of some form of tactile experience. And the experience that she's missing here is the passion and the anger and the emotion that comes with having an argument, albeit potentially a trivial one. So I can have a fight with him. Absurd. And that's what I want, an argument about who should put the dishes into the dishwasher, whose turn it is to sort the laundry, clean the toilet, something daily and unimportant in the big scheme of things. We could even have a fight about that, about unimportant, important. What a luxury it would be, not that we did much. These days, I script, so she plans them all in her head. She kind of has this kind of this daydream fight with him. I script whole fights in my head, the reconciliations too afterwards. And so we have this longing and this anxiety and this desire for stability. You can also see in this chapter, the passages are very fragmented. We don't normally have these quick jumps between her memories of the past or what she's doing now. And it's interesting that this chapter, with these very significant events in it, is broken up like that into these tiny fragments. They're like little snapshots of moments. I sit in the chair, the wreath on the ceiling floating above my head, and then look at how she describes the wreath, where of course we know that the previous handmaid managed to hang herself. So now she describes it like a frozen halo, and of course like this idea of an angel, but there's a very big hint there about it being kind of deathly, a zero, and of course that means nothing, something empty, a hole in space where a star exploded, a ring on the water where a stone's been thrown, all things white and circular. I wait for the day to unroll, for the earth to turn according to the round face of the implacable clock. The geometric days, which would go around and around, smoothly and oiled, sweat already on my upper lip. I wait for the arrival of the inevitable egg. And again, constantly we have this link between Offred's life experience and fertility. And this is the egg that Cora is bringing her for breakfast. But again, it's this is also what she's waiting for with this kind of, and again, that links to this idea that her life is counted in the by the lunar calendar, which of course is linked to periods as well, which will be lukewarm like the room and have a green film on the oak and will taste faintly of sulfur. Today, later, with Offglen on our shopping walk. And I kind of like this sort of kind of subheading title that we give here. It's like a diary form. It's very shorthand. Like Offred is taking notes of some kind, and of course we don't have any information from Offred about how this diary, this experience of Gilead, has been collated in any way, because of course we know that she isn't allowed to write anything down. We go to the church as usual and look at the graves, then to the wall, only two hanging on it today, one Catholic, not a priest though, the placard with an upside down cross, some other sect I don't recognise. So the upside down cross, which looks like that, is traditionally within the Catholic Church, the cross of St Peter, who was crucified upside down on the cross like that as a kind of mockery by the Romans who crucified him to Christianity. Casually it's linked to the idea of Satanism, but I don't think that really has anything to do with it. So there's just something about maybe this kind of commitment that this person has to real faith as opposed to the faith that Gilead experienced, and that's why they've put this symbol on him. But she doesn't recognize it. The body is marked only with a J in red. It doesn't mean Jewish. Those would be yellow stars, and of course we have Gilead here borrowing symbols from Nazi Germany. And it's important to remember that Gilead is created in the world in which there had been Nazi Germany. The world that Margaret Atwood writes Gilead into is America in the 1980s, and so America has gone through, you know, World War One, World War Two. It's gone through the race riots, it's gone through the abolition of slavery, and so Gilead is appropriating symbols of segregation from other cultures and creating its own meaning from them. So it doesn't mean Jewish, that would have been a yellow star. Anyway, there have been many of them. There haven't been many of them because they were declared the sons of Jacob and therefore special. And we've talked about this before. So the sons of Jacob is the name that the top commanders of Gilead give themselves. And of course, the sons of Jacob are then come from that relationship of Isaac and Rebekah, grandson of Abraham and Sarah. He later became he renamed himself Jacob, Israel, and became the patriarch of the Israelites. And so there is this kind of special link there in this Old Testament Christianity to Jacob. So the Jewish were declared special. They were given a choice. They could convert, and of course we're not quite sure what they're converting to, but they're converting to the beliefs of the theocracy of Gilead, or emigrate to Israel. A lot of them emigrated, if you can believe the news. I saw a boatload of them on the TV, leaning over the railings in their black coats, hats, long beards, trying to look as Jewish as possible. In costumes fished up from the past, the women with shawls over their heads, smiling and waving, a little stiffly, it's true, as if they were posing. And for another shot of the richer ones, lined up in planes. And so here we have, this choice to emigrate back to Israel, and potentially that fear of the outsider. And then we've got what continues to be a very familiar image of people getting onto boats and leaving. And again, this is this kind of idea of people that had emigrated to America now leaving to go back again. And so we have this description then of people who are trying to look as Jewish as possible, taking out costumes from the past as if they're posing. And so we have this desire to escape, which is perhaps this sense of this faux loyalty to being Jewish in order to get out of Gilead. And so then it said, Ofglen said, some other people got out that way by pretending to be Jewish, but it wasn't easy because of the test they gave you, which actually, if you want to convert to Judaism, you do have to do a test on the Torah, which is the Jewish version of the Old Testament. And you have to show quite a lot of Old Testament biblical knowledge. And they've tightened up on that now. And so we have, again, this irony here of this inverted image that we have of, again, Jews escaping persecution. But this time people are escaping persecution. You know, they can save themselves by leaving the Jewish, and people are trying to ironically pretend to be Jewish, which is this contrast to World War II. You don't get hanged for only being a Jew, though. You get hanged for being a nosy Jew, opinionated perhaps, who won't make the choice, or for pretending to convert. That's been on the TV too, raids at night, secret hordes, Jewish being dragged out from under beds, Torahs, Torliths, Morgan Davids, the owners of them, sun-faced, unrepentant, pushed by eyes against the walls of their bedroom, while the sorrowful voice of the announcer tells us voiceover about their perfidy, and ungratefulness, which is deceitfulness. And of course, we've got this kind of hypocrisy being highlighted here. But then we know that we're about to go into this section where there is a kind of this systematic hypocrisy in Gilead itself. So the J isn't for a Jew. What could it be? Jehovah's Witness? Jesuits? Whatever it meant. He's just as dead. And of course, the J is this a link again to what we suspect Ofred's real name is, which is June, and these kind of hints and sinister foreshadowing as being just as dead. And then here, whatever it is, he's just as dead. The reason for executions is beginning to be less and less clear. And now we have these kind of summary performative executions where potentially people are being executed for reasons that are less than real. After this ritual viewing, we continue on our way, heading as usual for some open space we can cross so we can talk, if you can call it talking. These clipped whispers, and of course clipped means shortened, curtailed, which is a really nice description, projected through the funnels of our wings. It's more like a telegram, a verbal semaphore, amputated speech. And that's very reminiscent of the creature as he's attempting to communicate with people. We never stand long in any one place. We don't want to be picked up for loitering. And there's just some nice repetitions of the word we in this section, as Ofred describes her conversation with Ofglen. And we have that sense of unity between these two characters now that they've found out that neither of them is pious as they thought they were. Today we turn in the opposite direction from Soul Scrolls, to where there's an open park of sorts with a large old building on it, ornate late Victorian with stained glass. It used to be called Memorial Hall, though I never knew what it was a memorial for. dead people of some kind. And of course, they have this conversation outside this memorial hall, this place, which she doesn't know what it's for, but it's symbolic and it represents something important from the past. Moira told me once that this is where the undergraduates ate in the early days of their university. And if a woman were in there, they'd throw buns at her, she said. And I'm just reminding you here that we've got this continued fragmentation of this moment. Why, I said, Moira became over the years increasingly versed in such anecdotes, and this anecdote about food being thrown at these women when they went into this room. I didn't like it much, grudge holding against the past. To make her go out, it was more like throwing a peanut at the elephant, I say. Moira laughed. She could always do that. Exotic monsters, she said, and that exotic monsters is the description of women as being both dangerous and desired. And Atwood here is just reminding us that segregation and this kind of extreme segregation of individuals, places where women could not go, is part of normal experience. We stand looking at this building, which is the shape more or less of a church, a cathedral. Ofglen says, I hear that's where the eyes hold their banquets. Who told you, I say? There's no one near. We can speak more freely, but out of habit, and that's their fear, we keep our voices low. The grapevine, she says, and she never defines that for us, and she explains why. She pauses, looks sideways at me. I can sense a blur of white as her wings move. There's a password, she says. And of course, the password is to enter the Aladdin's cave that is the resistance. A password, I said. What for? So you can tell, she says, who is and who isn't part of the resistance. Although I can't see what use it is for me to know, I ask. What is it then? Mayday, she says. I tested it on you once, and you'll remember that time very early on when they first met. Offred says, what a beautiful May day. And of course, she was testing to see whether, Ofglen said it, whether Offred was part of the resistance already. May day, I repeat. I remember that day. May day. And of course, we have the French version, which is, you know, I help. Don't use it unless you have to, Ofglen says. Ofglen. It isn't good for us to know about too many others, and we have this kind of idea of limits to how many other people you can know, so how many other people it can be tortured out of you, in this kind of network of people, in case you get caught. I find it hard to believe in these whisperings, these revelations, though I always do at the time. Afterwards, though, they seem improbable, childish evening, like something you do for fun, like a girls' club, like secrets at school. And of course, that's exactly what it is. And so this tongue-in-cheek description that describes this club as being infantile and ridiculous, but is also the way that these people is surviving, like the spy novels that I used to read on the weekends when I would have been finishing my homework, or like late night television, passwords, things that cannot be told, people with secrets, identities, dark linkages. This does not seem as if it ought to be true, the true shape of the world. But that is my own illusion, a hangover from a version of reality I learned in former times. And networks, networking, so this idea of making connections and links, one of my mother's old phrases, musty slang of yesteryear. Yet in her 60s, she still did something she called that, though as far as I could see, it meant having lunch with some other women. And I'm just going to leave it there for today, for now, and then I'll record the next section of this chapter in a separate video.